we are all here together to mark, or at least what we hope will mark, the start of a new conversation for the Republic of India. 7 decades ago, we were fighting for freedom in the face of threats of like colonialism, European supremacy. When we became independent and drafted a new constitution for ourselves, many thought that the ills of the past would be written away through promises of protecting the fundamental rights of citizens and demands for fundamental duties in return. The Constitution of India, which in my view is a liberal manifesto like unlike any other, was committed to ideals of democracy, free speech, civil liberties and secularism. Religion was not the founding basis for our nation, unlike some of our neighbors. Our right to speech and expression was not a gift or privilege that the government was intended to bestow upon us. It was our own right guaranteed by the Constitution and won after decades of struggle and sacrifice by the people of India. But today, several people like myself, including many of you who are gathered here today, people who value individual freedoms like free speech and believe earnestly in true and absolute gender and racial equality, are worried. Why are we worried? You may well ask. This is because it seems to many of us that we are at a moment in time where fundamental notions of modern India, that the India which was dreamed 7 decades ago, the India that we thought we had so beautifully constructed on paper of the Constitution, appears to be under existential threat. The India that we live in today has several disturbing traits. Every aspect that has anything to do with personal identity is being challenged. Our food habits are being curtailed. Our choice of entertainment is predetermined. Whom we select as our partners is also dictated. And saddest of all, any kind of dissent, our freedom to think and speak out our mind is stifled. Any kind of dissent, especially in spaces where it should be encouraged, such as universities and places of learning, is being curbed. So we are no longer celebrating unity in diversity or appreciating the many personal liberties that were encoded in Constitution. Instead, our loyalty to our country is being tested on new grounds, like sloganeering, flag raising. If you hold or propagate views that are in conflict with those of the power that be, you may be arrested in the middle of night, or worse, shot dead at point-blank range. So cow protectors have forced an epidemic of lynching. National institutions are being attacked, whether they are involved in governance, vigilance, in education, learning, on flimsy grounds, usually because the views of those running those institutions do not align of those who are running the country. In sum, we have lost sight of an India we wanted to build as a land of non-violence, inclusiveness and secularism. Our society today is filled with hate and violence, which is accompanied by suffering and fear among those who are at the receiving end of such hate and violence. This is where this collective that is before you today wants to step in. We want to reclaim the idea of India, the idea of Indian Republic that was envisaged 7 decades ago. Towards this, our group of concerned citizens who belong to different walks of life bring different ideas and expertise on the table, from the world of media, academia, literature, law, governance, experience in health, education, environment, social inclusion, transparency, and so on. So we have worked together to build this document, which we believe is a conversation starter on many changes we need to bring about it in order to reclaim our republic. Now, I'll just give a few examples and I'll finish. We propose that the dozens of antiquated draconian laws like UAPA or sedition, which are misused to curtail personal liberties and that unfortunately remain in our special statute book, need to be removed forthwith. We note that no efforts have been undertaken to protect the anti-corruption machinery in the country. Lokpal has not been appointed. Central Vigilance Commission has been diluted. The whistleblower bill has not been enforced. We urgently need some functional laws and institutions to deal with public grievances. That's a separate chapter which will be explained to you. We also discussed critical amendments needed to the judiciary to make it more independent, accessible, efficient and accountable. The process of appointment to the higher judiciary remains a closed book to the public. The collegium remains to strive. So issues relating to process of appointment, relating to post-retirement assignments are conveniently swept under the carpet, but the judiciary, which is an institution which I devoted most my best years of my life and which I deeply remain attached to, is sadly languishing due to lack of transparency in its functioning. There are other issues with the judiciary, like huge backlog and the several other issues. So we have discussed many other issues. There are questions of police reforms, electoral reforms, the way the media should be more free, more diverse, accountable, instituting a public health delivery system, accessible healthcare to all, properly staffing and funding government schools. Education is one of the issues which is dealt with. Then the agrarian reforms are also on the agenda, and the how to remove the farmers from the indebtedness. And these are the several questions which are dealt with here. So the objective of today's gathering is to start a conversation on these issues, and my senior colleagues are here to talk to you on various specific aspects which are covered by this particular document. Thank you.
And Justice Shah said the purpose of this document, redeeming the Republic, is to revive the democratic traditions, to revive dissent, but its purpose also is to point out a roadmap towards the economic revival in the conditions of the people. Now, as you know, Gandhiji's dream for free India is that we wipe away the tears from the eyes of every Indian. That is not what we have been able to do. On the contrary, notwithstanding very high rates of growth about which we keep hearing, India is now one of the most hungriest countries in the world. The level of hunger in India is now greater than that for the African continent as a whole, the average, and also is greater than what the United Nations defines as the least developed countries. Now, this amazing situation where we have high rates of growth on the one hand, which makes us apparently an emerging economic superpower, but at the same time, unprecedented levels of economic deprivation is something which needs to be immediately addressed if our democracy is to survive. Now, towards this end, some of us got together and have made these proposals. Yogin Jyaduji has worked from the agricultural front, and similarly others have worked on this. Basically, what we are suggesting is a minimum. Now, when we say a minimum, our approach is quite different from that which is these days being talked about, following what the economic survey had mentioned 2 years ago about cash transfers. You know, sometimes when we are talking about a minimum, typically we are talking about cash transfers, which is actually an income top-up scheme. And basically, people have different levels of income. You give additional amounts to each person so that they acquire a certain minimum level of monetary income. Our approach is very different from that. Our approach is to ensure a minimum cash income for everybody through employment guarantee on the one hand and employment guarantee at the minimum wage. If everybody is assured of employment, and if that employment is at least at the minimum wage, then obviously we are putting a floor to the minimum cash income. So we are demanding 150 days minimum of employment guarantee for every adult in urban as well as in rural India. And that at least at the minimum wage. So we provide a minimum cash income to everybody in this particular way. Additionally, we are demanding the provision of basic essential goods and services, which is in fact provided through state intervention. So state provisioning of basic essential goods and services, like for instance food, like healthcare, like education and so on. And also we are demanding a basic pension which would be given to everybody, and that would be half the minimum wage, at least half the minimum wage. So we are talking about employment guarantee, we are talking about basic essential services guarantee, and we are talking about a pension guarantee. In that sense, we propose to have the introduction of a basic minimum real income for every Indian, money income guaranteed through employment, the basic minimum real wage, and the services and goods, essential services and goods, guaranteed through state provisioning at affordable prices. So our idea is to put a floor to the real income for everybody. Questions, of course, will be asked, where do you get the amount of resources for this? As a matter of fact, India is one of the least taxed countries in the world, and particularly the level of direct taxation is amazingly low. We have hardly any wealth tax. So we are suggesting a combination of inheritance tax and wealth tax, as well as corporate social taxation, all of which we have calculated would bring us something like about 5% of the GDP, and that would be quite enough to provide for the kind of provisioning that we visualize. So it's a worked out program, and we would really like to commend this program to the attention of the various political commissions in this country who really want to carry forward our democratic tradition.
Accountability and participation was the first area, then judicial reforms, electoral reforms, reforming anti-democratic legislations and police reforms, media reforms, employment, food and social security reforms, health reforms, education reforms, agriculture reforms, and reforms required in the laws and policies related to inclusion of and justice for vulnerable populations, which Mr. Harsh Mandar will talk about, and the issue of environment, which is also a very, very serious area needing urgent reforms. I'll quickly talk about two of the areas which I was intimately associated with in this, that is judicial reforms and electoral reforms. So if you see this booklet, judicial reforms comes at page 12, if you have the booklet, and as Justice Shah mentioned, you see, judiciary today is in need of various reforms. One is that the judicial system is not accessible to the poor who cannot afford lawyers. So 80% of our population is virtually shut out of the judicial system altogether. Secondly, even those who can access the system keep waiting for years or decades to get justice because the wheels of justice move so slowly. Then you have a problem with the quality of judges and also with the integrity of judges, which brings us to the whole business of selection of judges, etc. And then you have a problem of accountability and transparency in the judicial system. So what we have proposed by way of reforms are listed as action points on page 13, where we say, first is improve access to justice by operationalizing informal Gram Nyayalayas. Actually, there is a Gram Nyayalay Act, but it has not been operationalized. Providing paralegal staff and increasing the number of courts at all levels. Law commissions have been saying for so many years that we need to increase the number of courts, but unfortunately, we have hardly done that. Second, improving the quality and independence of judicial appointments by setting up judicial appointment commissions to select judges at all levels in a rational and transparent manner. This is not the Judicial Appointments Commission proposed by the government. which is an ex officio body manned by sitting judges and a law minister, etc. We are proposing a full-time body, not an ex officio body of sitting judges, a full-time body of retired judges or other public persons who go about the job of selecting judges in a rational manner by first laying down a criteria, then going about selecting in a systematic manner with a fair degree of transparency also, so that people come to know as to what exactly this Judicial Appointments Commission is doing, how it is selecting judges, who are the judges who have been shortlisted. Third, ensuring proper accountability of judges by setting up independent Judicial Complaints Commission, empowered to receive and investigate complaints against judges and recommend action against them. Today we know that the only system of accountability is impeachment, which is not a practical process. Therefore, there needs to be an independent body, independent of the government, independent of the judiciary also. Today, one of the things that was proposed by way of a judicial accountability bill, which was brought earlier, was to have a committee of some senior sitting judges as the oversight commission, and thereafter senior sitting judges of the same high court against whose judge you have complained. Those have inherent conflicts of interest. We need an independent, fully independent and empowered body to investigate, to receive and investigate complaints against judges and recommend action. Fourth, increase transparency in the functioning of the judiciary by proactively putting out all information regarding cases in the public domain and videographing court proceedings. We need much greater transparency. Unfortunately, even the RTI Act, functioning of the RTI Act relating to the judiciary, has been thwarted by the judiciary itself. Even when information commissioners have asked the judiciary to reveal some information about pending cases, pending judgments, etc., that has been thwarted. So we need far greater transparency in the functioning of the judiciary, especially, and we need videographing of court proceedings so that a video record is available at all times to anybody. Improving independence of judges by removing all government influence in appointments of retired judges to commissions tribunals. Today we know that one of the ways in which independence of judges is compromised is by government luring retiring judges with post-retirement jobs. This has to stop. Government should play no role in offering any jobs, whether in commissions, tribunals, etc., to the retiring judges. This is the job to be done by a totally independent body like a Judicial Appointments Commission. Sixth, improving court and roster management by having professional court management team to rationalize and streamline listing of cases for better distribution of cases among benches towards a more efficient disposal without inordinate waste of time of litigants, judges and lawyers. Now this is something which can be easily done by having a professional body looking into this thing, because today so much time is wasted. People keep sitting for days altogether waiting for their case to come up. Their case doesn't come up because 60 cases are listed, only 10 cases can be heard. So all that can be rationalized by having a professional court management team. Lastly, ensuring adequate representation and diversity in the judiciary at all levels by ensuring fixed representation for women in the lower judiciary and progressively applying such standards to the appointments made in the higher judiciary vis-a-vis women, SC/ST and other minority communities. We have very, very few women or people from the SC/ST community or minorities in the judiciary. We need to progressively increase those numbers. So this is so far as judicial reforms is concerned. About electoral, you see, today we know that in electoral politics we have dominance of money power in this electoral system. So as Anna said, the whole game is satta se paisa aur paise se satta. This chakravyuh, this vicious circle has to be broken. And unfortunately, instead of reducing the role of money power in elections, we have seen some very retrograde amendments being made in the laws recently, which allow foreign companies to donate to political parties, which allow unlimited corporate donations to political parties, and which allow donations through anonymous electoral bonds. I mean, instead of increasing transparency in political funding, etc., they have reduced transparency by way of amendments made recently. All those need to be rolled back. Many other things need to be done. We have listed them as 9 points, which I'll quickly read out. Number one, reverse the recent regressive changes to laws on electoral funding that allow foreign funds, unlimited donations by corporates, and anonymous funding mechanisms like electoral bonds. Two, bring a comprehensive law for election financing reforms that prescribes electoral expenditure limit for political parties. Today there is no limit for political parties. Restrictions on use of cash. Today, you know that every candidate of major political parties is spending several times the limit, and you can't catch him because he's spending in cash. When the Prime Minister says that I introduced this demonetization to bring about a cashless economy, why can't political parties and candidates be made cashless? So we have said restrictions on use of cash, stronger disclosure requirements, compliance of disclosure requirements and penalties for non-adherence. Three, strengthen political transparency by declaring recognized parties as public authorities under the RTI Act, mandating declaration of sources of income by candidates, provision for verifying the declarations in the affidavits, and making expense statement of candidates public. You see, the CIC had said that political parties are public authorities and they have to comply with the RTI Act. Despite that not being challenged by any political party in any court, they have not complied with that. The next, amend the rules regarding use of EVMs. Now this is important. To provide for compulsory use of VVPAT enabled EVMs. Of course, today the Election Commission is saying that we will be using VVPATs in 2019 with every EVM. And verifying count of VVPAT slips against EVMs before declaration of result. You see, you must also count the paper ballots which are registered by the VVPAT machines along with the electronic voting machines. After all, what will happen? It will take maybe 10 more hours, 12 more hours before you can declare results. What's the problem with that? That will make it much better because EVMs can malfunction. EVMs can be, if you replace the chip of the EVM, they can be manipulated, etc. Then amend the constitution to provide for the appointment of election commissioners by a multi-member constitutional committee, ban post-retirement posts for commissioners, and provide the election commission with power to frame rules. See, today election commission is appointed purely by the government. And that is why you have this gentleman who is there presently. I don't want to say very much about him. His name was there in the radio tapes. If you look at this chief election commissioner today and you just do a search, you'll find what he is talking to Ms. Neera Radia about corruption in the judiciary, etc. So this business of the government alone appointing the election commissioner must stop. We must have a neutral body. For even the CBI chief, we have a high-powered committee. So we need some kind of neutral body to select election commissioners. Then provide for public funding. This is very important. Public funding of election by setting up a national election fund for electoral and other legitimate political expenses of each party or candidate on a reimbursement basis. That is, today we have a totally non-level playing field. There are big political parties which have a lot of money, other candidates who have no money. So we are saying that if a candidate secures more than a certain minimum number of votes, the state should reimburse him, at least after the elections, on the basis of the number of votes secured by him, whatever it is, 20 rupees, 50 rupees per vote or whatever. so that he is able to take a loan, fight the elections, and thereafter he gets reimbursed. That will make the playing field more level between parties which have a lot of money and candidates and parties which have no money. Amend election laws to provide mandatory and free airtime to all political parties, equitable access to information and media space during elections, and regulations to check paid news, conflict of interest, political ownership of media and misuse of public money. We are seeing that there is a serious problem with all this which needs to be stopped. Then amend the constitution to provide for at least one-third representation of women in parliament and state assembly. This issue has been hanging fire for a very long time. Every political party promises this but doesn't do it. This must be done now. Enact a law to regulate internal functioning of political parties to provide for transparency and internal democracy. Today, you see, political parties have become fiefdoms of one or two people. There are no proper elections, though their internal rules and constitution provide for proper elections, etc. But we find that nothing is enforced. We are saying that all those things must be enforced. That is part of the requirement of the Representation of People Act, and we must have systems which will enforce and ensure that. So these are the reforms regarding judiciary and electoral reforms. I now request...
Just to reiterate why this group came together. The elections are before us this summer. It is not simply a change in government that would be enough to change the destinies of our people. We need to know what any government which comes to power, what it will actually do and what it will do differently. And for that we want a clear commitment for the building of a just and humane society and country. India is passing through very difficult times, hate violence, and inequality at levels that are unimaginable. The recent Oxfam report said 9 people own as much wealth as half of Indian people. And in these circumstances, the continuance of hunger and deprivation at the levels that we see. There are a number of, because there are a number of vulnerable groups and a number of recommendations we made. I'll pick out just a few to place before us here. The first is the importance of an anti-discrimination law and an equal opportunities commission which mediates discrimination on any ground, on the ground of gender, caste, sexuality, religion, ethnicity, language, disability, and so on. This has been talked about a lot. It was talked in the Sachar committee as well. Most democracies now have constituted anti-discrimination laws and equal opportunity commissions. I have nowhere to go. I can go if there's violence, but if I was not given a job because I have a Muslim name, I don't have anywhere I can go to leave, and we need to have an anti-discrimination law. Secondly, to fight hate crimes, we've talked about the creation of a new law, and I would like to underline, and Justice Shah has also been thinking about this a lot. The law doesn't need to add to the powers of the state. What we need to do is to create a new provision of dereliction of duty by public officials. If a public official does not act to protect people when there is hate violence targeting them, then they should be punished. And Manipur, a small state, has actually passed the first law in this country very recently on lynching with this central provision of dereliction of duty of public officials, without even the requirement of prior permission by the state to prosecute the person. Third thing that we want to highlight here is ensuring a minimal critical presence of women. We talk about reservations, but a number of other steps concerning sexual harassment, making workplaces safe for women in parliament, in judiciary, in the police, and in public services at all levels. Fourthly, the restoration of the planning process, because we had a tribal sub-plan, we had a special component plan with mandatory budgetary allocations to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. When the plans were abolished, the sub-plan also disappeared. And so there is today no statutory provisioning of budgets for tribal and scheduled castes, gender budgeting, disability budgeting. So the restoration of the planning process with these measures backed by the law. Assam, when we talk about minorities and vulnerable populations, Assam at this moment is facing a very difficult situation with regard to the National Register of Citizens, the NRC. So we've talked about, we have a peculiar situation in which the law, the whole legal system is built around the question of burden of proof, that you are innocent till proved guilty. But in Assam, we have a situation in which you are a foreigner, the state says you are a foreigner until you prove that you are not a foreigner, and you have to produce documents which most of us, even in the middle class in cities, will not be able to produce vintage documents of the kind that are required. So reversing the burden of proof. Scholarships for scheduled caste, scheduled tribe and Muslim girls for study right through from primary, secondary to higher education. Providing basic infrastructure and services for persons with different disabilities as a guarantee, including those with psychiatric disability. A national commission to end, to look at why sewer deaths continue and the ending of sewer deaths. Ensuring, establishing a judicial commission to look at the targeting, particularly of Muslims, under terror laws, and tribals in Maoist affected areas. Why is there this kind of targeting, and to reverse this? And one last thing that I would say here, which might sound peripheral, but it is very significant, is to actually change the requirement from when you have to give your name and then your father's name. Instead of your father's name, you need to give your mother's name. And it will change things a lot in terms of empowering single women and their place in society. The group regarding healthcare is also not here, so I just wanted to put in a few words around the healthcare question about universal healthcare as a right. Many studies have shown that one of the most important reasons why people slip into poverty is because of catastrophic health expenditure requirements. And India has one of the lowest public spending on health, and out-of-pocket spending on health is twice the amount of public spending, which is extraordinary, and it has very few parallels. The right to universal health care is not the right to universal health care insurance, which is what the government is saying, which is basically strengthening only the private health care system. We are talking about free health care through public provisioning, free medicines, free diagnostics and inpatient care, with a special focus on primary and secondary health care and generic medicine. This requires an accelerated public spending on healthcare up to at least 3% of the GDP, and the creation of adequate public health, public health cadre at different levels. So universal healthcare is also an extremely significant part of the imagination or the reimagination of a country where the poor have a life, short a life of both safety and dignity.
पार्टिसिपेशन जो कि हम कहते हैं जानकारी भागीदारी सुनवाई और कार्रवाई इन सब के लिए वी फेल्ट दैट एंड दिस हैज बीन अ लॉन्ग स्टैंडिंग डिमांड दैट देयर मस्ट बी कंकरेंट मेजर्स लेजिस्लेटिव एंड पॉलिसी मेजर्स दैट नीड टू बी इन प्लेस टू लुक इनटू इश्यूज ऑफ करप्शन एंड ग्रीवेंस रिड्रेस एंड फेलियर ऑफ सर्विस डिलीवरी बाय द सिस्टम एंड ऑल्सो इन टर्म्स ऑफ गिविंग स्पेस two citizens to participate in the process of policy making and in the process of legislative making laws. Unfortunately, and as has already been mentioned by Justice Shah and Prashant, there have been long-standing demands which have not been addressed through successive governments, but especially in the last 5 years, we have seen a huge rollback in many of these measures, which we seek to address through this document as well. So the first thing is that on corruption, on big ticket corruption, the Lokpal had been demanded, and in fact it was something that was supported by the then opposition, which has now been in government. But what we have seen is that in the last 5 years there has not been appointment of even a single Lokpal in the country at the center. In fact, the demand for the Lokpal came from the fact that there was need for an independent and empowered body to look into cases of high-level corruption. What has finally happened is that because the necessary changes were not brought through amendments to the Lokpal law, the leader of opposition does not find space in that law, and now the selection committee is primarily comprised of government officials and is a preponderance of the government. And we believe that it would be a huge travesty, it would go against the spirit of the law if appointments are made in this manner. So the demand is that the Lokpal must be appointed, they must be appointed in keeping with the spirit of the law, and the appointments must be made transparently, because currently whatever information is being sought is being stonewalled, it's not being provided to citizens, we don't know what is happening in terms of the appointment process. There has been, even before appointment of Lokpal, there has been dilution of the law. So no longer can we actually access assets and liabilities of spouses and dependent children of public officials. So that is a huge problem. Again, that's one of the asks in this document. The other issue, which has been a very vexed issue, is the issue of small corruption, everyday corruption. और हमारे देश में भ्रष्टाचार का जिस तरीके का कैरेक्टर है उसमें केवल बिग टिकट करप्शन नहीं है डाउन टू द लोएस्ट लेवल चाहे राशन हो पेंशन हो हर एक अपने हेल्थ के अधिकार हो स्कूलों में पढ़ाई की बात हो सब जगह पे लोगों से भ्रष्टाचार हो रहा है इनएफिशिएंसीज है फॉर विच देयर वाज नीड फॉर अ ग्रीवेंस रिड्रेस लॉ एक ऐसा कानून जिससे अगर कोई शिकायत करे कि उन तक उनके राइट्स और एंटाइटलमेंट्स नहीं पहुंच रहे तो एक समयबद्ध तरीके में वो उसके ऊपर सुनवाई की जाए तो ग्रीवेंस रिड्रेस बिल व्हिच हैड बीन इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन पार्लियामेंट देयर वाज डिस्कशन ऑन इट इट आल्सो वेंट टू द स्टैंडिंग कमिटी ऑफ पार्लियामेंट इट वाज सपोज्ड टू बी री इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इट हैज नॉट बीन री इंट्रोड्यूस्ड नॉट बीन पास्ड एंड वन ऑफ द मेजर आस्क्स इन दिस डॉक्यूमेंट इज फॉर एन इनएक्टमेंट ऑफ a grievance redress law which will empower people because what we are essentially saying is that we do not believe in this centralized system of governance of accountability where we are told that you know one person or one office will take care of all corruption but actually to empower people through the right to information law through laws which actually empower them to be able to take action and fight corruption So this particular legislation is demanded, it's a cross-cutting issue and it's been demanded so that people can actually access their rights and entitlements under various laws and schemes that the government has promulgated. The other issue is, like Justice Shah said, that anyone who comes forward to complain or कोई भी भ्रष्टाचार के खिलाफ आवाज उठाते हैं तो उन्हीं के ऊपर प्रहार हो रहा है उन्हीं पे अटैक्स हो रहे हैं और उनकी हत्याएं भी हो रही हैं पिछले साल भी 18 से ज्यादा विसल ब्लोअर्स की हत्या कर दी गई केवल क्योंकि उन्होंने सूचना मांगी और भ्रष्टाचार को उजागर किया जो विसल ब्लोअर प्रोटेक्शन कानून है वो एक फरवरी में 2014 में 5 साल हो गए उसको पार्लियामेंट ने पारित किया था पर आज तक उसको क्रियान्वित नहीं किया गया है द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ द लॉ इज समथिंग दैट वी हैव डिमांडेड मस्ट बी डन एंड इट्स वन ऑफ द आस्क्स इन दिस डॉक्यूमेंट इफ यू लुक एट इट The other issue is the dilution and in many ways ek tarah se jo prahar raha hai on the Prevention of Corruption Act which is the foundational law which defines what is corruption and what should be done with allegations of corruption and complaints of corruption. So while the governments we see they are giving themselves clean chits ke kuch corruption nahi ho raha hai but on the other hand we are seeing that the Prevention of Corruption Act has been diluted and all the institutions that are meant to look into cases of corruption and hold the government accountable are being attacked and diluted so prevention of corruption act mein jo ek bahut bada amendment laya gaya hai wo hai ki jo koi bhi complaint hogi corruption se related the government will give sanction for investigation and prosecution in that complaint That is a huge dilution of this law. If we have to file, if a complaint is filed, somebody comes forward, takes a huge risk on corruption, and then the government will decide whether there will even be an inquiry or investigation into that case. And that is something that has that is also mentioned here. I won't go into greater detail, but a rollback of the amendments that have been carried out to the Prevention of Corruption Act to dilute it. And finally, the Right to Information Law, which has empowered citizens across the country. Every year we have close to 6 million RTI applications filed in India because people are asking for information on their basic services but also of the highest offices in government. And there has been a consistent attack on the Right to Information Law and on the regime. So the government has refused to make appointments to information commissions. Not a single appointment has been made to the Central Information Commission without people going to court and the court giving directions. And also, there is an amendment that has been proposed to dilute the Right to Information Law. So one of the asks is that in order for the whole fight against corruption, for the whole to empower people to hold the government accountable and to participate, there have to be legislations, there have to be policies that have to empower people and not empower some central agency to act. So all of these are essential, and of course clubbed with a pre-legislative consultation law and social audit law, which will also empower people.
मैं सबसे पहले आपको ये दस्तावेज क्या है इसके बारे में एक बार दोबारा कुछ बोलना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि कई साथी बाद में आए. It's an extraordinary document, a product of a very unusual effort. एक महीना बाकी है इस देश में चुनाव शुरू होने को. आज से एक महीने बाद आचार संहिता लग जाएगी, इलेक्शन शुरू हो जाएंगे. और जो हमने इस देश के पिछले 3-4 इलेक्शंस का देखा है, इलेक्शंस का मतलब खूब शोर होगा, गाली गलौज होगी, तू तू मैं मैं होगा, और बाकी टाइम बैठ के सिर्फ फोरकास्टिंग होगी, कौन जीतेगा, ये और ये मिलके सरकार बनाएंगे, ये होगा वो होगा. सब्सटेंटिव इश्यूज पे कोई बात नहीं होती, पूरा चुनाव निकल जाता है दुनिया के जिसे सबसे बड़ा लोकतंत्र हम कहते हैं, और एक काम की बात पे चर्चा नहीं. एक बार फिर उसी का माहौल बन रहा है, अचानक किसी को मंदिर याद आ गया है, कोई रिजर्वेशन आ गई है, सब चीज एकदम आ गई ताकि असली सवाल पे डिस्कशन ना हो सके. इसलिए कुछ महीना पहले हम कई साथियों ने मिलकर सोचा, जस्टिस शाह ने इनिशिएटिव लिया, प्रशांत जी अंजलि जी ने इनिशिएटिव लिया, और देश के कई अलग अलग क्षेत्र से बुद्धिजीवी हैं, पत्रकार हैं, आंदोलनकारी हैं, कार्यकर्ता हैं, पुराने प्रशासक लोग हैं, सभी तरह के लोगों ने मिलकर फैसला किया कि हमें देश के सामने एक कार्यसूची, एक एजेंडा रखना चाहिए कि इस देश में चुनाव सचमुच किस सवाल पे होना चाहिए और अगली सरकार को क्या करना चाहिए. हमने देखा कि इससे पहले ऐसी कई कोशिशें हुई लेकिन उसमें भी एक दो कसर रह जाती, या तो कोई सिर्फ एक सेक्टर के लिए डिमांड कर लेते हैं, किसी ने कहा कि मुझे राइट टू एजुकेशन पे ये चीज चाहिए अगले इलेक्शन में, तो केवल राइट टू एजुकेशन पे आपको 50 पेज का डॉक्यूमेंट मिल जाएगा लेकिन सब सेक्टर्स पे नहीं मिलेगा. या कई बार ऐसा हो जाता है कि तमाम तरह की मांग कर ली जाती है, मांग कैसे पूरी हो सकती है, उसमें पैसा कितना खर्च होगा, एक्चुअली उसके लिए करना क्या पड़ेगा, इस पे किसी को कोई चिंता नहीं. और चूंकि ये चीजें नॉन सीरियस रहती हैं, इसलिए बाद में कोई उन पर ध्यान नहीं देता. पार्टियां भी अपने मैनिफेस्टो में जो दिल में आए लिख देती हैं, बाद में तो लागू किसने करना है, लिख दो अभी तो जो कहना है कर दो. इसलिए हमने अपने ऊपर एक सीमा बांधी, हमने कहा कि जो भी मांग यहां रखेंगे उसके लिए विस्तार में हम बताएंगे कि वो कैसे हो सकती है, उसकी समय सीमा बताएंगे, एक टाइम टेबल उसके लिए देंगे, और उसमें क्या खर्चा होगा वो भी बताएंगे. इसलिए ये जो डॉक्यूमेंट आपके हाथ में है ये तो अभी एक छोटी सी समरी है. जैसा प्रशांत जी ने बताया, 11 कमेटीज हैं, दे वर 11 कमेटीज, ईच ऑफ द कमेटीज हैज गिवन ए फ्यू रिकमेंडेशंस जो यहां पे हैं. इन ऑल वी हैव 108 रिकमेंडेशंस, मगर इस हर रिकमेंडेशन के पीछे एक बहुत इलेबोरेट डॉक्यूमेंट है. हम उम्मीद कर रहे हैं कि जब हमारी वेबसाइट पे आप इसे देखेंगे तो जब आप क्लिक करेंगे, कोई भी आइटम आपने क्लिक किया, मान लीजिए 1.5, strengthen the right to information regime by whatever term. आप इस पे क्लिक करेंगे तो आपको इसके साथ पूरा एक पेज मिलेगा जो डिटेल्स बताएगा कि ये एक्चुअली कैसे किया जा सकता है. और अगर इसमें किसी भी तरह का बजटरी कमिटमेंट इन्वॉल्व है तो कितना खर्चा होगा, और जैसा प्रभात पटनायक सर ने इशारा किया था, इस पे भी काम किया गया है कि ये पैसा आएगा कहां से. मेरे ख्याल से पहली बार इस देश में किसी भी समूह ने इतनी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव एक्सरसाइज की, सभी क्षेत्रों में क्या करने की जरूरत है, उसे कैसे किया जाएगा, क्या टाइमलाइंस होंगी, कितना पैसा खर्च होगा और पैसा कहां से आएगा. ये सारा काम इस समूह ने किया है और आपके हाथ में उसका एक छोटा सा डॉक्यूमेंट है. सिर्फ इसका पूरा डिटेल डॉक्यूमेंट शायद 150-200 पेज का हो जाता है, इसलिए छापा नहीं है, वो वेबसाइट पे उपलब्ध रहेगा, हर चीज की पूरी डिटेल्स रहेंगी. और ये जो आपको छोटा सा हैंडआउट दिया गया था, ये इसकी भी समरी है. सो आप अगर इसे पढ़ सकते हैं तो आपको इसे पढ़ने की कोई जरूरत नहीं, पूरी बुकलेट पढ़ सकते हैं तो इसे पढ़ने की जरूरत नहीं है. इस हैंडआउट में सिर्फ इस बुकलेट में से 19 आइडियाज को पिक कर लिया है, थोड़ा राइम करता है 2019 आइडियाज फॉर 2019, बस इतना ही, कुछ मेन आइडियाज को पिक कर लिया है ताकि उस पर पब्लिक में चर्चा हो सके. मेरी जिम्मेवारी है कि मैं थोड़ा सा आपको उन क्षेत्रों के बारे में बताऊं जिसके बारे में अभी तक चर्चा नहीं हुई. मैं बस जस्ट छूंगा क्योंकि आपके पास डॉक्यूमेंट है, आप पढ़ लेंगे, देख लेंगे. एग्रीकल्चर में चूंकि बहुत चर्चा है पिछले कुछ दिनों से, अचानक इस देश में सबको किसान याद आ गया है. किसान था पहले, याद नहीं आता था 6 महीना पहले तक, अब सबको याद आ गया है. और दो चीजों पर चर्चा है कुल मिला के, एक तो लोन माफी और दूसरा कैश इनकम उसके हाथ में देने. अब सबसे बड़ी बात यह याद रखना है कि इस देश के किसानों की, किसान आंदोलनों की ये मांग नहीं है, ये उनकी सबसे पहली मांग नहीं है. सबसे पहली मांग है कि उन्हें अपने फसल का वाजिब दाम मिले. इसको कोई करने को तैयार नहीं क्योंकि मुश्किल काम है, काफी इसमें सोचना पड़ेगा और काफी पैसा लगेगा. तो उस सवाल को, और उसके लिए संसद में बिल ऑलरेडी है, ऑल इंडिया किसान संघर्ष समन्वय समिति की तरफ से रखा गया है जो देश के बहुत बड़े किसान आंदोलनों का समूह है. तो इस डॉक्यूमेंट में हमने कहा है कि वो पहली मांग होनी चाहिए, उसके मैकेनिज्म क्या है पूरा प्रिस्क्राइब किए. दूसरा, किसान को सिर्फ लोन वेवर नहीं, फ्रीडम फ्रॉम इंडेबटेडनेस. केरला में सन 2006 में बहुत महत्वपूर्ण कानून आया था जिसने एक रेगुलर परमानेंट इंस्टीट्यूशन सेटअप की, डेट रिलीफ कमीशन. उस तर्ज पे हम कह रहे हैं कि एक नेशनल डेट एंड डिजास्टर रिलीफ कमीशन होना चाहिए जो कि पूरी तरह से कर्ज से मुक्त करे. ये एक बार कर दिया, इतने एकड़ तक का, इतने तारीख तक का कर दिया, 6 महीने बाद फिर वो वापस आपके पास आ जाए, अब और करो, ये तरीका नहीं है. तो हमने ये कहा है. उसके अलावा जो किसान की बुनियादी समस्याएं हैं कि उसके पास इनपुट कॉस्ट जो है वो दनादन बढ़ती जा रही है, उसको कंट्रोल करने का कोई सिस्टम नहीं है, जो जमीन है जमीन को छीनने की कोशिश की जा रही है. जैसा आपने देखा 2013 में संसद ने कानून पास किया, 5 साल हो गए संसद का कानून को लागू नहीं होने दिया इस सरकार ने किसी ना किसी बहाने से. फॉरेस्ट एक्ट बना, फॉरेस्ट एक्ट को डाइल्यूट कर दिया गया है. तो छीनने की कोशिश हुई है देने की बजाय. और हमारी इस दस्तावेज में प्रयास ये है कि किसान की आर्थिक स्थिति को बेहतर करने के लिए किसान को केंद्र में रखते, प्रोडक्शन नहीं प्रोड्यूसर, उसको केंद्र में रखते हुए कैसे एक तरह की न्यू डील, एक नया पैकेज पूरा किसान के लिए इवॉल्व किया जा सकता है, उसके विस्तार से बताया गया है. वैसे में ये दस्तावेज कहता है कि हमें राज्य को, सरकार को अपनी ये जो बुनियादी जिम्मेवारी है, शिक्षा स्वास्थ्य तो बिल्कुल बुनियादी जिम्मेवारी है, अपनी बुनियादी जिम्मेवारी से हटेगा नहीं. और ये जो RTE कानून पास हुआ था 2009 में, उस कानून को उसकी ठीक स्पिरिट में लागू किया जाए, सभी स्कूलों को RTE के दायरे में लाया जाए और पब्लिक एजुकेशन पर एक्सपेंडिचर खर्चा बढ़ाया जाए, 6% तक उसको GDP का किया जाए, जिसमें उच्च शिक्षा में भी कम से कम एक GDP का 1% उच्च शिक्षा में जो यूनिवर्सिटीज, पब्लिक सेक्टर की यूनिवर्सिटीज है उसके ऊपर खर्चा करना, तमाम जितने भी पोजीशंस हैं, लाखों पोजीशन टीचर्स की आज खाली हैं। इन पोजीशंस को, चाहे वो टीचर्स की हो, चाहे वो स्वास्थ्य विभाग में हो, इन सब पोजीशंस को भरना। तो शिक्षा के बारे में पूरे डिटेल रिकमेंडेशंस हैं इसमें। पर्यावरण के सवाल पे, पर्यावरण के सवाल पे इस तमाम जो विस्तृत हमारी रिकमेंडेशंस हैं, उसकी शुरुआत इससे करते हैं कि इंडिपेंडेंट एनवायरमेंटल कमीशन हो देश में, जिसका काम हो सरकार से बिल्कुल अलग रह के तमाम तरह के पॉल्यूशन, तमाम तरह के एनवायरमेंटल जो डिजास्टर्स हैं उसको मॉनिटर करना और उसके बारे में एक्शन लेना। इंडिपेंडेंट एंड एम्पावर्ड एनवायरमेंटल कमीशन जो कि इसके बारे में स्टैंडर्ड्स ले डाउन करेगा, रेगुलेशंस बनाएगा और उसकी कंप्लायंस को एंश्योर करेगा। ऑटोनोमस एजेंसी टू कवर एंड प्रोटेक्ट द रिवर्स, इंक्रीज द नंबर ऑफ एयर क्वालिटी मॉनिटर स्टेशंस, नेशनल एनर्जी पॉलिसी फॉर फेज्ड शिफ्ट टू डिसेंट्रलाइज्ड रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी ओवर द नेक्स्ट 15 ईयर्स, एंड इंसेंटिवाइज पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट एंड नॉन मोटराइज्ड प्राइवेट व्हीकल्स। ये तमाम क्षेत्रों के बारे में हमने रिकमेंडेशंस किए हैं, ये सब आपके सामने, आप इसे पढ़ेंगे। मैं फिर यही कहना चाहता हूं कि आप देखेंगे जिस किस किस एरिना से लोग इसमें आए, ये तो इस डॉक्यूमेंट में भी आखिर में लिस्ट है, मेन डॉक्यूमेंट